Hobby. A hobby is a regular activity that is done for enjoyment, typically during one's leisure time. Hobbies can include collecting themed items and objects, engaging in creative and artistic pursuits, playing sports, or pursuing other amusements. A list of hobbies is lengthy and always changing as interests and fashion change. By continually participating in a particular hobby, one can acquire substantial skills and knowledge in that area. Engagement in hobbies has increased since the late 19th century as workers have more leisure time and advancing production and technology have provided more support for leisure activities. Hobbies tend to follow trends in society. For example, stamp collecting was popular during the 19th and 20th centuries as postal systems were the main means of communication, while video games are more popular nowadays following technological advances. Hobbyists are a part of a wider group of people engaged in leisure pursuits where the boundaries of each group overlap to some extent. The serious leisure perspective groups hobbyists with amateurs and volunteers and identifies three broad groups of leisure activity, with hobbies being found mainly in the serious leisure category. A. Casual leisure is intrinsically rewarding, short-lived, pleasurable activity requiring little or no preparation. B. Serious leisure is the systematic pursuit of an amateur, hobbyist, or volunteer that is substantial, rewarding and results in a sense of accomplishment. C. Project-based leisure is a short-term, often a one-off project that is rewarding. In the 16th century, the term hobben had the meaning of small horse and pony. The term hobby horse was documented in a 1557 payment confirmation for a hobby horse from Reading, England. The item, originally called a tourney horse, was made of a wooden or basketwork frame with an artificial tail and head. It was designed for a child to mimic riding a real horse. By 1816, the derivative, hobby, was introduced into the vocabulary of a number of English people. Over the course of subsequent centuries, the term came to be associated with recreation and leisure. In the 17th century, the term was used in a pejorative sense by suggesting that a hobby was a childish pursuit. However, in the 18th century, with a more industrial society and more leisure time, hobbies took on greater respectability. A hobby is also called a pastime, derived from the use of hobbies to pass the time. A hobby became an activity that is practiced regularly and usually with some worthwhile purpose. Hobbies are usually, but not always, practiced primarily for interest and enjoyment, rather than financial reward. Hobbies were originally described as pursuits that others thought somewhat childish or trivial. However, as early as 1676, Sir Matthew Hale, in Contemplations Moral and Divine, wrote, "Almost every person hath some hobby horse or other wherein he prides himself." He was acknowledging that a hobby horse produces a legitimate sense of pride. By the mid-18th century, there was a flourishing of hobbies as working people had more regular hours of work and greater leisure time. They spent more time to pursue interests that brought them satisfaction. However, there was concern that these working people might not use their leisure time in worthwhile pursuits. The hope of weaning people away from bad habits by the provision of counter-attractions came to the fore in the 1830s, and has rarely waned since. Initially, the bad habits were perceived to be of a sensual and physical nature, and the counter-attractions, or perhaps more accurately alternatives, deliberately cultivated rationality and the intellect. The flourishing book and magazine trade of the day encouraged worthwhile hobbies and pursuits. The burgeoning manufacturing trade made materials used in hobbies cheap and was responsive to the changing interests of hobbyists. The English have been identified as enthusiastic hobbyists, as George Orwell observed. A new English characteristic which is so much a part of us that we barely notice it, is the addiction to hobbies and spare time occupations, the privateness of English life. We are a nation of flower lovers, but also a nation of stamp collectors, pigeon fanciers, amateur carpenters, coupon snippers, darts players, crossword puzzle fans. All the culture that is most truly native centers round things which, even when they are communal, are not official: the pub, the football match, the back garden, the fireside, and the niece cup of tea. Deciding what to include in a list of hobbies provokes debate because it is difficult to decide which pleasurable pastimes can also be described as hobbies. During the 20th century, the term hobby usually brought to mind activities such as stamp collecting, embroidery, knitting, painting, woodwork, photography, but not activities like listening to music, watching television, or reading. These latter activities bring pleasure but lack the sense of achievement that is usually associated with a hobby. They are usually not structured, organized pursuits, as most hobbies are. The pleasure of a hobby is usually associated with making something of value or achieving something of value. Such leisure is socially valorized precisely because it produces feelings of satisfaction with something that looks very much like work but that is done of its own sake. Hobbies are a contradiction. They take work and turn it into leisure, and take leisure and turn it into work. The terms amateur and hobbyist are often used interchangeably. Stebbins has a framework which distinguishes the terms as a useful categorization of leisure in which he separates casual leisure from serious leisure. He describes serious leisure as undertaken by amateurs, hobbyists, and volunteers. Amateurs engage in pursuits that have a professional counterpart, such as playing an instrument or astronomy. Hobbyists engage in five broad types of activity: collecting, making and tinkering, like embroidery and car restoration, activity participation, like fishing and singing, sports and games, and liberal arts hobbies, like languages, cuisine, literature. Volunteers commit to organizations where they work as guides, counselors, gardeners, and so on. The separation of the amateur from the hobbyist is because the amateur has the ethos of the professional practitioner as a guide to practice. An amateur clarinetist is conscious of the role and procedures of a professional clarinetist. A large proportion of hobbies are mainly solitary in nature. However, individual pursuit of a hobby often includes club memberships, organized sharing of products, and regular communication between participants. For many hobbies, there is an important role in being in touch with fellow hobbyists. Some hobbies are of communal nature, like choral singing and volunteering. During the 20th century, there was extensive research into the important role that play has in human development. While most evident in childhood, play continues throughout life for many adults in the form of games, hobbies, and sport. The type of hobbies that people engage in changes with time. In the 21st century, the video game industry is a very large hobby involving millions of kids and adults in various forms of play. Stamp collecting has declined along with the decline in the importance of the postal system. Woodwork and knitting have declined as hobbies as manufactured goods provide cheap alternatives for handmade goods. Through the internet, an online community has become a hobby for many people, sharing advice, information and support, and in some cases, allowing a traditional hobby, such as collecting, to flourish and support trading in a new environment. People who engage in hobbies have an interest in and time to pursue them. Children have been an important group of hobbyists because they are enthusiastic for collecting, making and exploring. In addition to this, they have the leisure time that allows them to pursue those hobbies. The growth in hobbies occurred during industrialization, which gave workers set time for leisure. During the Depression, there was an increase in the participation in hobbies because the unemployed had the time and a desire to be purposefully occupied. Hobbies are often pursued with an increased interest by retired people because they have the time and seek the intellectual and physical stimulation a hobby provides. Studies of aging in society support the value of hobbies in healthy aging. Hobbies are a diverse set of activities, and it is difficult to categorize them in a logical manner. The following categorization of hobbies was developed by Stebbins. Collecting includes seeking, locating, acquiring, organizing, cataloging, displaying and storing. Collecting is appealing to many people due to their interest in a particular subject and a desire to categorize and make order out of complexity. Some collectors are generalists, accumulating items from countries of the world. Others focus on a subtopic within their area of interest, perhaps 19th century postage stamps, milk bottle labels from Sussex, or Mongolian harnesses and tack. Collecting is an ancient hobby, with a list of coin collectors showing Caesar Augustus as one. Sometimes collectors have turned their hobby into a business, becoming commercial dealers that trade in the items being collected. An alternative to collecting physical objects is collecting records of events of a particular kind. Examples include train spotting, birdwatching, aircraft spotting, rail fans, and any other form of systematic recording a particular phenomenon. The recording form can be written, photographic, online, etc. Scale modeling is making a replica of a real-life object in a smaller scale and dates back to prehistoric times, with small clay dolls and other children's toys that have been found near known populated areas. The Persians, Greeks, and Romans took the form to a greater depth during their years of domination off Western world, using scale replicas of enemy fortifications, coastal defense lines, and other geographic fixtures to plan battles. At the turn of the industrial age and through the 1920s, families could afford things such as electric trains, wind-up toys, typically boats or cars, and the increasingly valuable tin toy soldiers. Model engineering refers to building functioning machinery in metal, such as internal combustion motors and live steam models or locomotives. This is a demanding hobby that requires a multitude of large and expensive tools, such as lathes and mills. This hobby originated in the United Kingdom in the late 19th century, later spreading and flourishing in the mid-20th century. Due to the expense and space required, it is becoming rare. Scale modeling as we know it today became popular shortly after World War II. Before 1946, children as well as adults were content in carving and shaping wooden replicas from block wood kits, often depicting enemy aircraft to help with identification in case of an invasion. With the advent of modern plastics, the amount of skill required to get the basic shape accurately shown for any given subject was lessened, making it easier for people of all ages to begin assembling replicas in varying scales. Superheroes, airplanes, boats, cars, tanks, artillery, and even figures of soldiers became quite popular subjects to build, paint, and display. Although almost any subject can be found in almost any scale, there are common scales for such miniatures which remain constant today. 3D printing is a relatively new technology and already a major hobby as the cost of printers has fallen sharply. It is a good example of how hobbyists quickly engage with new technologies, communicate with one another and become producers related to their former hobby. 3D modeling is the process of making mathematical representations of three-dimensional items and is an aspect of 3D printing. Dressmaking has been a major hobby up until the late 20th century, in order to make cheap clothes, but also as a creative design and craft challenge. It has been reduced by the low-cost manufactured clothes. Cooking is for some people an interest, a hobby, a challenge and a source of significant satisfaction. For many other people it is a job, a chore, a duty, like cleaning. In the early 21st century the importance of cooking as a hobby was demonstrated by the high popularity of competitive television cooking programs. Residential gardening most often takes place in or about one's own residence, in a space referred to as the garden. Although a garden typically is located on land near a residence, it may also be located on a roof, in an atrium, on a balcony, in a window box, or on a patio or vivarium. Gardening also takes place in non-residential green areas, such as parks, public or semi-public gardens, botanical gardens or zoological gardens, amusement and theme parks, along transportation corridors, and around tourist attractions and hotels. In these situations, a staff of gardeners or groundskeepers maintains the gardens. Indoor gardening is growing houseplants within the residence or building, in a conservatory, or in a greenhouse. Indoor gardens are sometimes incorporated into air conditioning or heating systems. Water gardening is growing plants that have adapted to pools and ponds. Bog gardens are also considered a type of water garden. These all require special conditions and considerations. A simple water garden may consist solely of a tub containing the water and plants. Container gardening is concerned with growing plants in containers that are placed above the ground. Tinkering is dabbling with the making process, often applied to the hobby of tinkering with car repairs, and various kinds of restoration, of furniture, antique cars, etc. It also applies to household tinkering, repairing a wall, laying a pathway, etc. Making and tinkering hobbies also include higher-end projects like building or restoring a car, or building a computer from individual parts, like CPUs and SSD's. For computer-savvy do-it-yourself hobbyists, CNC, computer numerical control, machining is also popular. A CNC machine can be assembled and programmed to make different parts from wood or metal. Outdoor pursuits are the group of activities which occur outdoors. These hobbies include gardening, hill walking, hiking, backpacking, cycling, canoeing, climbing, caving, fishing, hunting, wildlife viewing, as bird watching, and engaging in water sports and snow sports. Depending on an individual's desired level of adrenaline, outdoors experiences are considered one type of hobby. While many enjoy an adrenaline rush or use to an escape from reality, outdoor recreational activities can also be an extremely effective medium in education and team building. As interest increases, so has the desire for commercial outdoor pursuits. Outdoor recreational supply stores have opened in large numbers and are thriving, as of outdoor pursuit journalism and magazines, both on paper and the internet. The increased accessibility of outdoor pursuit resources has been the source of some negative publicity over the years, with complaints of the destruction of landscape. An example is the destruction of hillsides as footpaths are eroded due to an excessive number of visitors. Many hobbies involve performances by the hobbyist, such as singing, acting, juggling, magic, dancing, playing a musical instrument, martial arts, and other performing arts. Some hobbies may result in an end product. Examples of this would be woodworking, photography, movie making, jewelry making, software projects such as photoshopping and home music or video production, making bracelets, artistic projects such as drawing, painting, writing, cosplay, design, creation, and wearing a costume based on an already existing creative property, creating models out of cardstock or paper, called papercraft. Many of these fall under the category visual arts. Reading, books, ebooks, magazines, comics, or newspapers, along with browsing the internet, is a common hobby, and one that can trace its origins back hundreds of years. A love of literature, later in life, may be sparked by an interest in reading children's literature as a child. Many of these fall under the category literary arts. Stebbins makes a distinction between an amateur sports person playing a sport that has a professional equivalent such as football or tennis and a hobbyist playing a less formal sport or game that are rule-bound but have no professional equivalent like deck tennis and long-distance trekking. Amateur sport ranges from very informal play to highly competitive practice. Evidence suggests that playing sports helps improve physical and mental health. There have been many instances where hobbyists and amateurs have achieved significant discoveries and developments. These are a small sample. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.